Hey there, and welcome to my channel. I want a CNC mill. Nowadays, CNC machines are essential for prototyping and production. And there are good reasons for that. They're fast, precise, and can make complicated geometries with ease. There are some high-quality machines out there, but they're often relatively big and expensive. The cheap and small mills, however, often lack in rigidity and precision. So, I want to try building my own. Inspired by the Magneto X 3D printer, I want to use linear motors. Just out of curiosity, I wanted to try building one myself. To design our prototype, we need to cover the basics of a three-phase synchronous motor and how to unwrap it. If you're familiar with this topic, feel free to skip ahead. The simplest type of a three-phase synchronous motor consists of three equally spaced windings in the stator. I call them A, B, and C. And a freely rotating permanent magnet as the rotor. The green arrow represents the flux of the rotor, while the other yellow ones represent the flux of each coil. Summing these gives you the resulting stator flux. To maximize the torque output, the fields should remain perpendicular to each other. We will discuss field-oriented controls in more detail in a future video, but for now, this is all you need to know. Now, carefully unroll the stator. Place the windings so they are equally spaced in a row. Do the same for the permanent magnets. Notice, in both sketches the north pole is next to the A coil, and the south pole is between coil B and C. The magnets I want to use for this prototype are 10mm in width. I'm not sure about the spacing between them right now, and this might be reduced for the final motor. For now, I will stick with 10mm, so I can also experiment with a Halbach array without ordering more magnets. If we do the math, we need to space the windings 1/3 of the magnet track length. For this instance, we would need to fit the iron core and the windings into a 13mm space. Keep in mind that we want to avoid magnetic saturation of the core and make as many turns as possible while keeping the resistance low. This helps with power losses and temperature management. Honestly, 13mm is too tight and we ain't gonna cut it. Let's copy our sketch from above and make a few changes. Instead of a 2-pole rotor, we use a 4-pole rotor. We keep the stator as it is and see how it behaves when we apply current to the windings. In this particular case, coil A would attract the north pole. Notice how the force goes right through the center of the rotor, which won't produce any torque. Coil B, however, is somewhere in between a north and a south pole. Assuming a field like this causes both an attracting force to the south pole and a repelling force to the north pole. Now, the force has a distance to the fulcrum, and therefore it applies torque to the shaft. Same for coil C. Let's unroll it again. In this configuration, the total length of the array of magnets comes to 80mm. Plug in the numbers and we've doubled the space for our coils. After some research and looking at reference images, that's the design I came up with. The track consists of an aluminum base, a steel magnet backplate, a couple 40x10x10mm neodymium magnets, spacers to keep them apart, and 10 M3 countersunk bolts. The fossa is made from 3 copper windings and laminated iron core. Please forgive me, but we will make the core in a future video. For now, we substitute it with a 3D printed one. Let's start with the base. Starting with a 100x20mm aluminum bar, I roughly cut it to length and began fly cutting the surfaces to make them nice and shiny. Some of you might wonder if this part even serves a function or not. Well, not really. I included this in the initial design stage and decided to keep it. Since I'm relatively new to milling, I saw this as a great opportunity to practice a little. And let me tell you, it was a good idea. What happened, you ask? Well, I basically scrapped the part. How? I somehow assumed my vise was through with the x-axis of the mill, which unfortunately was not. And then it happened. I flipped the base to drill the mounting holes for the magnet backplate, and long story short, they were off by a millimeter or so. To make things worse, I welded this shut. You can imagine what happened. Anyway, I corrected my mistakes and we're back on track. Next, I squared up the ends and brought the base to its final length of 25cm. For mounting, I drilled 4.5mm holes on each side. Later, I decided to use 20x20mm extrusions to build a Testrig. These extrusions use M5 screws, so we need to enlarge the holes later. Additionally, we might benefit from some reamed holes in the future. so I included a few in the design. Finally, I made out a slot for the magnets and made a quick cut to keep things interesting and not bore you too much. To make the magnet backplate, I roughly marked out its size. Not my best guess. And cut it out using an angle grinder. The steel sheet which I'm using here is 4mm thick, because that's what I had on hand. In the CAD, however, I used 2mm. In the end, I went with 3, because the screws would have been a bit too long. Now I take it to its final width and also make both sides parallel to each other. What you're seeing here is the definition of flexible. If you have a second vise, use it to hold the other end. Or you can take two long and thick pieces of metal and clamp the thin sheet in between. However, I kept the feeds and speeds low and got away with this setup. Now also bring this to length. You know what I need to make in the future? A machinist's check. Or just clamp it closer to the vise and then flip it. It wasn't that bad though, and I eventually got away with that and started making the mounting holes. These are for the 10 M3 countersunk bolts I mentioned earlier. I made them using a 2.5mm drill and a hammer as an improvised jack to keep it from flexing. The only thing left was to tap these 10 holes. To reduce its thickness, I thought it would be a good idea to bolt it directly to the base and reinforce it that way. After that, I cleaned it further with brake cleaner and applied some cold blue and a drop of oil to make it corrosion resistant. As I mentioned earlier, I use a 3D printed core instead of iron. A laminated iron core entirely made from scratch would mean a lot of additional work, and the video is already getting out of control. No worries, we will make one. Just not now. I'm quickly modeling this guy and send it to my resin printer. You can use whatever material you like. I chose resin because my FDM printer suffers from C-wobble and needs some care before I can print something useful. To make the mover windings, I 3D printed this two-piece winding jig. I covered all the surfaces in ordinary candle wax and melted it with a hairdryer. This makes sure that it flows in between the layer lines and into every corner. Two reasons for that. First, it helps with taking the two pieces apart due to slippery properties. And second, it acts like a mold release. I will superglue the windings together, so they are holding their shape. Guess how long 3 coils took me to make? Whopping 5 hours. We definitely need to build a winding machine. With the help of a box cutter, we gently free the coil from its jig without damaging the insulation. Then we can take it apart and do some rework if this is necessary. Alright, now there's not much to say about. In my opinion, the coils turned out pretty alright and all that's left is assembly. The fit between the core and the windings is relatively tight, so they should hold in place like that. I soldered them in a Y configuration. Be careful to not mix up the wires, or the motor won't work properly. Alright, that's it for this video. To control the motor, I use the Nucleo F303RE in combination with ST's IHM16M1 motor driver shield. I sandwich a 2mm acrylic sheet in between to give the mover a smooth surface to glide on. This is a quick and dirty solution, but sufficient for testing purposes. In the future, the mover will ride on a linear rail. To power the setup, I use a 12V power supply that I had laying around. I'm using ST's motor profiler software, or rather its startup sequence, to control the actuator. I won't go much into detail here, because that's a topic for another video. Now the moment you all have been waiting for. Drumroll please! In the next video, we will build a test rig with an encoder, an indicator and a load cell to get an idea of this motor's performance. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to the channel for more content like this. If you have any questions or suggestions, feel free to leave a comment below. Until next time, take care and see you soon.